So today's agenda is we have constructors, packages in Java, access specifiers in Java, and static data members, static methods. We'll take some exercises, we'll wind up. So we'll start up with constructors. Why you need a constructor and what is the use of a constructor? So whenever you create an object, memory gets allocated on the heap, right? Using the new operator, you create an object. Some memory gets allocated and the reference lies on the stack. So the problem is what values will be assigned to it initially when that memory gets allocated. Some kind of garbage values can be part of it. So by default, there can be initialization happening. What is initialization? If you store, if you say you have int marks or int a in your class variable, a can be initialized to zero initially. Once when the memory gets allocated, you can also go with initialization of that memory. So when you have a string or arrays, you know, your reference can be to null. So initializing an allocation happening on the heap by default can happen using a constructor. You can also pass the values that you want to initialize when an object gets created. So that is a constructor, and we'll see the rules for the constructor. The constructor name should be the same name as the class. If I have a class faculty, what is that we are going to see here? We are going to have a constructor. Constructor that will have the same name as the class. Even if this F is capital letter, this F should be capital letter. It should be the same name as your class, and it should not have any return type, even void. So that should be, these are the rules for a constructor. And what happens is when an object is created for a faculty class, this constructor will be called, and then the code inside this will be executed so that your class members will be initialized to those values. So that's the use of a constructor. And let's take a look at a constructor here. What I'm trying to do here is I'm using a student's class, just calling, writing a constructor, public students. So here I have put void faculty. It is wrong, right? It should not have a return type. So it's public faculty. So public students, and then you put some values here. So when, once when that object is created on the heap, it will assign all the initial values to the data items on the heap. So that is the use of constructor. So let's go and have a look at a simple constructor. We'll try and code it in Eclipse. So let me say I have this students class here, which we have already coded in our previous classes. And once when I create an object, automatically everything should be initialized to some value. Say we'll have, how will you create a constructor? It's public, and don't give any return type. You give the exact class name, and then you just give any value you want to initialize. Say if I want to initialize everything to test, name, registration number, everything is initialized to test, then marks will initialize to zero, something like that. And then you should, it's a function, so you should not miss these brackets. So once when this is done, you know, you just go and you know, you can also go and print some certain values here. So if I have this so you can print certain values here, name, registration number, and marks. We'll just go and print whatever that is initialized from within the constructor. That's it. So what we are trying to do here is we are trying to initialize the values when the object is created and print it. So we'll go and create an object for this class. I'll go to my main file. I'll create an object for this class, students s is equal to new students. So once when you create an object for this class, what should happen is the constructor will be automatically called, and that print statement will execute with the values that got initialized. So let's go and execute this. So you see here, you can see the values, test, test, name, registration number, and marks initialized by default to these values. So it, we didn't call any method like s.faculty or anything. It got automatically called and it was initialized. So that is that type of constructor is called a default constructor or a no argument constructor. They're not passing any arguments. Say there is one more thing, you know, I am giving this, I'm just mentioning what values I should initialize my variables with when the object is created, right? If I don't give this default constructor, the compiler itself will invoke a constructor which is not visible to you, and it will initialize it with some standard value. Say if it's an integer, it will initialize it to zero. If it is an string, initialize that to null. So automatically a default constructor will be called if you don't have a constructor on your own. But if you mention a constructor, that default constructor will be this. So your constructor will be called and all the values will be initialized to what you are specifying here. So compiler also has an hidden default constructor which will be called when you're not specifying anything from within. What is a parameterized constructor? Say I want to initialize, pass some values while the object is getting created. It should not be by it's like every time what's the problem here is, if I have 2-3 objects created, all the objects will be initialized with test, test and zero. Because every time an object is created, the same constructor is getting called, right? But when an object is getting created, for that object, I want to pass some values and initialize it. So that is called a parameterized constructor. Let's see how a parameterized constructor works. So for a parameterized constructor, what I'm going to do is, let me show you. I'm just going to pass some values here. Say, I want to pass the name, registration number, like that. So I will pass, say, Satish is the name, and registration number can be 12BCE1. And then I want to pass some marks to, say, 30 marks. So for this object S, when it is getting created, you take these values and initialize it. So in that case, how will this constructor receive that? You should have some methods your arguments for your method. So you will get a string as an input. So I'll say name and then string registration number. So I just use I registration number and then int marks. So this is the input that's coming in. So when your constructor is being called, this will be, let me reduce the font size. So this will be automatically called, and then how will you initialize the values? Name is equal to my name. So whatever that is coming in will be moving into your object. So I registration number and marks is I marks. Got it? So all those values will be mapped here and will be assigned to your object. So once when the object is created, so what will be the values assigned for it? Whatever that's coming in as input. Let's go and run this one, save our file. Let's check the error is clear now. Yeah. So let's save our file. So what should be the output now? Whatever this was done. That's it. So what is the use of this? So if I create another object, want to initialize that with some other values, I can just go and create another object. Just copy and create. You can pass your own values. So this is object S1. And then I want to have some other values while this object gets initialized. So I can pass the values here. And when I save this and run this, you see two different objects having two different initialized initializations. But when you use that constructor without arguments, every object will be initialized with the same set of values. So that is our parameterized constructor. You pass some parameters. One thing you have to keep in mind is, suppose I have a parameterized constructor here and in my code, I'm not accepting parameters. I have a default constructor like this. Then what will happen is, you will definitely get an error because you're passing parameters and there is a mismatch between the arguments you're passing. You're passing parameters, you don't have a constructor that will receive those parameters. So you will get an error. So you have to, when you're passing parameters, you have to get that here. So there's one more thing called constructor overloading. What do you mean by constructor overloading? Suppose I have two functions with the same name, but then which function I should call depends on the type of arguments I pass. So here I have a parameterized constructor and a default constructor. When I don't give the parameters, the default constructor will be called. When I give the parameters, the parameterized constructor will be called. So this is called method overloading. We would have known that earlier. So it's a simple thing. So if I don't pass parameters, say I want everything to be initialized to test. If I pass parameters, that should be initialized to those values. So and then zero. So if this is what happens when I don't pass parameters. If I pass parameters, what should I have? So I can put this. It's just a repetition of the same thing, string I name. So it's marks is equal. We'll have and you can have this printed again, name plus registration number plus marks. So that is what we are trying to print. So we have two constructors here. So when I don't pass parameters, this will be executed. When I pass parameters, the next one will be executed. Basic concepts, right? So for one of the objects, I will not pass any value. So it will invoke the default constructor. So let's see what happens when you run this. So see, for the first object, test test 0 got called. That constructor was used. For the next object, this parameterized constructor was used. So constructors are used for initializing an object when the object is getting allocated on the heap. So that's our idea about constructors. Let's move forward and let's look at what are packages in Java. What do you mean by a package in Java? It's nothing but a group of classes, interfaces, and other packages put together. So you have a group of classes put together, say class A, class B, everything is put together in one package. You can group that under a package, you can give a name for that package. So that becomes a package. You also have interfaces, you can also have a package within a package. Since we have not learned interfaces, we'll skip that for now. So how you declare a package? Say if I have a package university, I can have class students, class faculty, class parents within that package. And how can you import a package into your code? You do package.name.star. You have to give package dot, this is the package name, dot star. You have to use dot star to import a package. So that's all about packages. We'll go and see how to create a package in Eclipse. So let's go and create a package in Eclipse. You go to your project, right click. It takes some time. New package, you just go to new package and then you give some package name. Say if I want to create an university package and then finish. So your package is getting created, but within this package you have to add many classes. So we'll add the faculty class within this package. So let's go and add a new, inside you right click on that package and give a new class file, and then this class file name is faculty, and it is this is within the. So you see here, package is university and a class gets created within that package. Whereas our main program is in package morning session, it's a different package. So we can add any number of classes to our university package. Let me right click and add one more class file there. We'll add the parents class also here. So we'll add a class. So we'll say that is a parents class inside this package. So finish. So you have a faculty class, we have two class files inside one package here. And we'll have some methods for our classes. We'll say public, we'll have an allow method, public void display, and then we'll do a, we'll say hello. Okay, hello from faculty here. This is one, hello from parents, right? Sorry. So that is one method, and we'll also have another method inside faculty. So this will be again display faculty, something like that, and then we can say hello from faculty. Okay, so this one we'll do. So we have created two classes under this particular package, and I am right now in another package. How can I import this package into my code? So what you have to do is you have to just do import. You have to give the package name here, university, and then dot star. So when you give dot star, all the classes get imported here. So what you can do is you can directly go and create an object for that class. So that is, say, now I can go and access faculty F1 is equal to new faculty. I can create an object and then I can call the method to F1 dot hello, right? Display faculty, something like that. So now I have imported the faculty and parents class in my code. See, you use this arrays class, right? Import java.util.arrays. So you use arrays.sort. Dot sort is a method inside the arrays class, and you are using a package import there. The same kind of a thing. So what you are trying to do here is you are going to have an import statement. Say if I want to import only the faculty class, I'll just give import.faculty. If you want to import all the classes, I'll give a dot star. So that's how an import works. So you now know the difference between packages, right? We group classes under different names. We give them, we call them packages. Why it is important? You get modularity in the sense, you know, you can reuse a lot of code. Say I want to sort arrays, I just import that package and everybody imports that package and reuses the code. That is one thing, and you'll also avoid naming conflicts. So I have a class here, I have a class there in a different package. So if I use the same name for the classes, you'll not have a naming conflict. So yes, if you import them in the same thing, then there'll be a naming conflict. So that is the, you know, these are some of the advantages of having packages. So why did we learn packages all of a sudden? There's a reason behind that, because we have done all these things. We are going to talk about access specifiers. What is an access specifier? And they are also known as visibility specifiers. So when you take a look at my code, wherever I have used public in many places, public. And what is this public? And what is this private? You also have private, protected, default in Java. So we might have learned all these things in C++. We'll again revisit them with some picturization. Say if I have package university, and then I have this class, user class, with a public username. And if I have other classes in my same package, I'll be able to access username from other classes in the same package. So this class can be a subclass, an inherited class you can access, or a class which is not part of the inheritance. So you can access anywhere. Even if you have another package and you have another class outside, and even within that class, you can access the variable here. So public is the highest level of access. You can access it from anywhere. What about private access? If I have the same private string username, and if I try to do the same thing that I have shown you, everywhere you're trying to access, it will lead to an error, because you can access this only within this class, within the member functions of those class, of that class. So private is a very strict level of access. You cannot do any kind of access outside the classes. What about default access? So what is private? Can I go and do something? You know, if I have students dot Java, see, I have declared everything to be private inside my students class, right? If I come to my main, I create an object of type students. This is very basic, right? Students S is equal to new students. And then if I try to do S dot name or something like that, you see immediately it throws me an error, because it's not visible. You should not access that. So it's hidden. That is one thing of private. What is default? What do you mean by default? Default is nothing but I don't give any specifiers. It's like I just declare my variables. By default, what will happen is the question. I don't give anything. That is in C++, by default, it becomes a private, I guess. But here, by default, it takes up the default access specifier. What is this default access specifier? So if you declare a variable without any public, private, or protected, what you can do is you can access that variable within all the classes of your package. So this class can be a class that inherits this class, you can access the variable. Or a class which is totally independent, even in that class, you can access the variable. So inside a package, your default variables are accessible. But then outside the package, you cannot access. Say if I'm trying to access the same variable outside the package in some other class, you'll get an error. So you should be, you know, cautious about using the kind of access specifiers. What about protected? There is one more thing called protected. Since we have not learnt inheritance, but we might be knowing inheritance from C++. So what is inheritance? Who can explain me that? Okay, so protected is nothing but, you know, it's specifically for the classes that inherit from your class, so for the subclasses, right? So when you put something as protected in Java, you can access it within the member functions of your class. You can also access it in the subclass which extends your parent class. And you can also access that in another class inside the package which is not part of the inheritance. So that's how, you know, it works in Java. But when you have another package totally, you have another package, and within that class, if you are trying to access this protected variable, you'll get an issue. But in another package, if you extend this class, you'll be able to access that. So whichever class extends this class, you'll be able to access that variable within that class. And whichever class is part of the package, you'll be able to access the protected variable too, like a default variable. But when you're trying to access it outside in some other package, in some other class, which is not extending your main this parent class, then you'll not be able to access the protected variable. So I'm sorry for those who know who are new to inheritance. We'll be looking at inheritance after our vacation. But this is just for information that we have so many types of access specifiers. What is the role of all these access specifiers? How they help you? Yes. Very good. So that's the answer. You want to hide something. So you have this arrays class. In arrays, you are able to access dot sort. Do you know what other methods are there? Will you be able to access the variables of the class? They will not allow you the access because they will give you only what you should access. So when you are creating a reusable code, you want to give it to others to reuse it. You cannot allow them. It depends on the kind of application you are developing, but you want something to be hidden. As I told you, there can be certain member functions which are totally hidden from the outside world. It will be helpful only for performing certain internal tasks. So such kind of functions, you can have it to be private, and variables which you don't want the users to really mess up with can be private. But when you are in an inheritance hierarchy, you have to give what all things can be given to your, you know, subclasses should be given as protected. So all these things depends on your application. It's application specific, but you should not have everything to be public. If you write code wherein everything is public, then definitely something is not so good. So you have to think, you have to analyze the domain before you come to a conclusion on what should be given and what should be hidden. Okay, these things are theoretical things. I have put diagrams and explained to you. So we'll now go to another concept, static members. What are static members and methods in a class? What are static members? Yeah, it's class variable common to all objects. So if all your objects want to share the value in one particular variable, then it becomes a static variable. So we'll go and look at how to declare a static variable. You can give the access specifier for your static variable. You can give whatever access specifier you want to. And then what you have to do is you have to give your keyword static, and then the type for that variable, and then you should also go with an initialization for that variable. So this is not tied to any object, it is a class variable. Okay, so let us take up some exercises here. Display the number of objects created for students. See, if I keep on creating objects, I want to count the number of objects that has been created. Another exercise is assign a unique registration number for each student using the static member. So what we'll do is, I want to count the number of objects that are being created. So let me have this thing like public static count. I initialize that to zero. So I say this member is a static member and is part of the class. How I initialize it, I give static count is equal to zero. Now what I have to do is, I have to go and create inside my constructor. I'll have one constructor here. Let me comment the remaining things to have it simple. So in this constructor, what I will do is whenever an object is created, I'm going to just go and initialize my count to count plus plus. Static int count. Here I missed the data type, that's why it's giving an error. So every time when I go and create an object, this constructor will automatically increment count. This count is shared between all the objects. So once when this is incremented to 1, when you create another object, that will increment it to 2. So what we'll do is we'll also print this value out. So we'll print count out every time we create an object. So what we'll do is we'll go and create two objects. Here we'll go and create two objects. Okay, this is one object. Let me create another object. Student G is equal to new student. So what happens is here that static variable gets incremented by 1. Here that should be incremented by one more an account, so it should be 2. So let's go and check whether we are able to find the count. So first it's 1, next from 1 it goes to 2. So that variable is shared between objects. It's not for one specific object. So that's what we understand. We have to understand how this actually, where this variable is allocated on the memory. Is it on the heap or within an object? Then it will be very specific for an object, right? So it should be somewhere else. So once when you compile your code and move that bytecode to your method area, the next step happens is it will identify all the static variables in your code, and then it will initialize that and put that in your method area. And what happens once when the initialization for static variables are done, we'll go for creation of our object. Say student S is equal to new student, right? So you will have this memory allocated on the stack for your main to hold all your local variables. So the first object gets created, the reference is on the stack, whereas the object gets created on the heap. That is for the first object. And once when this is created, your count is something, a class variable. It's not tied to any object. So what happens is when you increase count, count gets increased on the method area. So again, when you go on with the creation of the next object S2, it's on the stack, the reference goes, it's on the heap. So now this will increase the count, right? Count is once that is shared, so count will go to 2. So all the objects will access that same memory area and have that value. So this is the use of static variable. And can you try this piece of code alone? I add this. What is that? We add another exercise, right? Assign a unique registration number for each student. So you're getting the registration number from the student. Can you assign a unique registration number for each student using this particular static concept? Can you go and try that one out? Say, where is that student's class? Here you have, instead of getting the registration number from the student, we'll assign that internally. So we'll comment that code out. And how will you assign? So every time I'm incrementing count to 1, so I can say register number is equal to, I'll have 12 BCE, say it's 12 BCE, and then let's have some 1 plus count. I guess that will be the thing. And then we'll print the registration number out. So every time when we create an object, the registration number for the student should be incremented or something like that. We'll go and check this one. So we have 2 students here. What would be the registration numbers when we run this code? So 12 BCE1, 12 BCE2. Just an, but we'll not do like this, we'll allocate registration numbers using auto increment in the database, or we'll generate that unique ID in the database. Just to tell you how static members work. Okay, so that's the thing. We have another thing called static methods in Java. A static data member is common for all the objects. You can also invoke it as class name dot variable name. Likewise, have you used any static methods in Java? Main is a very good example. So you have this main, right? That's static. What is the use of this kind of a function? Say you take a look at this function, it is within this class. But you're not creating an instance of class first to invoke the main method, right? So main is not for any particular specific object. It is a function for the class. So you don't need any instance to actually invoke main. You're not doing first f1.main. So static is again not specific to any object. You can invoke that using the class name dot function name. So another thing that you have to learn with static is there are certain things you have to learn with static. You cannot directly access a class instance variable within your static. Say for instance, I have a variable inside my class first like int a, and what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to do a is equal to 4. So this will throw an error. You cannot directly access a non-static class variable inside your static method. That is not allowed, because the class variable is always mapped to an object, right? Object dot class variable name. But static is a class based function, so you cannot access a class instance variable inside your static. And another thing is you can access a static variable directly inside your class. Static int, say I have count is equal to some 24 or something like that. I can directly go and print that inside my class here. So that is allowed. You can access a static variable inside your static method, but you can never access a class instance variable directly that is non-static inside your static method. There's one more thing. A static method will always invoke another static method. You cannot invoke a class member function from your static method. Say I have another member function here, public, let's have it as public void display. I'm going to display hello from here. So it's another function within my class. So let me just go and say hello. So if I'm trying to call this particular class member function from within my static method, it will not allow you. Say if I try to access display here, display, just call display from within my static method. So it will throw an error. You can call only static methods from within a static method. So how can you call a static method is just make it as public static void display. So now display is cleared of the errors. So these are some of the properties of a static method. And how can you call a static method is you can call it using the class name dot method name. So directly you can invoke a static method. So this method is common for the all the objects. It's not tied to any object. So now what I want you to do is I want you to take up an exercise. Since you know static methods now, you're very comfortable with that. Let's take up an exercise on static methods. Sort an array of objects. So you have the student object where every student you're going to get the marks. You're going to have a static method called sort method inside your class. You're going to get the array of objects you've created in that class method, which is static, and you're going to sort the array of objects and print the sorted list of objects using the marks. Say we have three student objects. Each student gets 9 marks, 4 marks and 5 marks. So you have to sort it out based on the marks in the ascending order. Say student who scores 5 should come in the front. The details of the students who scored 5 should be in the front. So I want you to write this, have this method in your student's class as static method. Get the input as an array of objects you have created and you have to sort it. Can you please try that now? Write this code. Please write this code. We have 5 minutes. Let me also try this one. And it's just sorting an array of objects using the marks as the criteria in the ascending order using a static member in your class. So how will you define, you know, I want to create an array of student objects. How can I create that? First of all, you know how to create an array of student objects, right? Let me go and try that one. Students, yes, it's an array. So you'll have new students. And then let me have 3 students in my thing. And how will you allocate? So this creates an array on the heap with null references. So you have 2 references which are null. So suppose you want to allocate memory here. What you are going to do? For every reference, you are going to create a reference to the heap, right? S of I is equal to now memory gets allocated for all the objects. References pointing from your array locations to your heap. And next, what you're going to do for every student, you're going to get the name and marks. So how will you get the students data? Let me comment all these constructors too. We don't need that for now. So what we'll do is we'll get the name here, enter name, And here I have enter marks. So we are going to get name and marks for every student. We'll also comment this registration number. We'll comment our static. So we'll have only name and marks for every student here. So let us go and call this method addInfo for all the objects. How will you call addInfo? It's just again the same loop. In that also, I less than 3, I plus plus. So what you're going to do is S of I dot addInfo. So you're going to add all the info. So now values get added to your array of objects. Next thing is you have to go and sort it. So how will you go and sort an array of objects? For that, you should have some method in your student's class. Some method you should have. I told that method should be static because it's common for all the objects. So we can say public static. We can say obj sort. And it's not going to return anything. So it's void object sort. And then we are going to get an array of student objects as the input. So students is the type and it's an array of student objects. So you give that. You get an array of student objects here. And then what you're going to do inside this one, you're going to sort this array using the concept. How will you sort an array? We can use the bubble sort that we know, right? Int I is equal to 0, I less than. So it is of the length of the array minus 1. Maximum n minus 1 passes you will use. And then I plus plus. So then we'll have for int j is equal to 0, j less than s dot length, so it's index minus I comparisons, and then j plus plus. And how will you sort if s of I dot s of j I get this issue. We'll finish this off. S of j dot marks, we are using the marks for sorting, right? If s of j dot marks is greater than s of j plus 1 dot marks. So if this happens, we need to swap the objects or change the references in the array. So how we are going to change that is you're going to use another temporary object of type students. So students temp is equal to new students. So this object we are going to use to swap. So what we are going to do here is temp will get whatever that is in s of I, s of j. And S of j will get whatever that is there in S of j plus 1. We are just swapping the references here. S of j plus 1 should get whatever that is there in temp. So I think our sorting is done. Finally, you come out of that particular loop. After that, you are going to print the sorted array of objects. You can use an enhanced for loop here. So you are going to get objects of type students from, say, K from S, from the array S, we are going to map every student object to my for loop, and then I'm going to call my method k dot view info. View info will display the data back to the, you know, for each object back to the user. It's a member function. So this should be the array that sorts it based on the marks. We'll save this. Let's hope this one runs. I don't know, I'm getting some issue here. Is there an issue somewhere? So there's a registration number which we have removed, right? I have to remove that. So registration number plus marks. So we'll save this one. We'll go to first.java. Now we'll call this static method. How will you call? You just give the class name dot object sort. And then you pass the array of objects. You just give the name S. So this passes this array of objects that you have created to that static method. Let's go and run this one and wind up. I hope it should work. So I will enter some names here, Satish, and then marks is 9. We'll have Ram, marks to be 5. And then we'll have Tom, marks to be 4. So Tom 4, Ram 5, and Satish 9. So we have used a static method. How you invoke that? Class name dot static method name. Okay. Thank you.